You're listening to a learning podcast on injection safety for nursing school students. This podcast is a production of the New York State Department of Health and the New York One and Only Campaign. Now your presenter, Ernest Clement, infection preventionist from the New York State Department of Health Bureau of Healthcare Associated Infections.
Hello, my name's Ernie Clement. I'm a nurse epidemiologist with the New York State Department of Health, and today we're going to discuss safe injections. The World Health Organization defines a safe injection as one that does not harm the recipient, does not expose the provider to any avoidable risks, and does not result in waste that is dangerous for the community. We include this slide to point out that there are at least three components to a safe injection. Now, we know you hear a lot about what you need to do to avoid exposing yourselves to risk, such as needle sticks, but today we're going to talk about avoiding harm to the recipient, especially with regard to blood-borne pathogen transmission. Now, at this point in your education, you should know that you should not reuse needles and syringes or similar equipment. And you're probably wondering who in this day and age would do such a thing, and why are we even talking about this? Well, unfortunately, we still see unsafe practices involving some subtle and even not so subtle situations where equipment is reused. The figure here shows a potential transmission. You have an infectious person, equipment is used on that person and is either not disposed of properly or not reprocessed properly and then used on a susceptible person. The red dots indicate contamination. Before we go any further, we should talk about the infectious risks of unsafe injections. One of the most concerning bloodborne pathogen is hepatitis B, and that's partially because chronically infected people tend to have a very high viral load in their blood. So there can be enough virus to cause infections even in the absence of visible blood. Also, hepatitis B virus is stable in the environment for a week or even longer, like on surfaces or in vials. Hepatitis C can also cause infection even in the absence of visible blood, and it's stable in the environment at least overnight, but less than 4 days. And the reason that interval is worded so awkwardly is that the commonly referenced study analyzed viability overnight, where they found live virus, and then at 4 days, where they didn't find live virus. We don't know whether it can survive for 1 or 2 or even 3 days. We do know that it remains viable for longer periods in cool liquids, like inside medication vials. The third viral pathogen we worry about is HIV. Fortunately, it's a rather delicate virus and generally doesn't survive well in the environment, but it can survive in syringes for several days, and there has been documentation of transmission from patient to patient. In one outpatient example, the mode of transmission was suspected to be contamination of multi-dose vials of saline, and the reference to that study is at the bottom of the slide. Finally, there's also a risk from bacterial pathogens. Respiratory flora can cause infections like meningitis from spinal injections performed without a mask. And many types of bacteria can contaminate medication. The ones I have listed here are just a few that were found on a brief literature review. So why should we be concerned about injection practices and point-of-care blood testing in healthcare facilities? This slide describes the findings of a study of over 5,000 clinicians who work with parenteral medications. Now, most were registered nurses, but there were also some doctors and other professionals, and all the percentages refer to clinicians who answered sometimes or always. For instance, 6% of the respondents, sometimes or always, would reuse a single-dose vial for more than one patient. This is a problem because of the possibility of bacterial contamination, since single-dose vials generally don't contain preservative, and also possible transmission of bloodborne pathogens. 1% said they sometimes or always use the same syringe with a new needle to administer medications to more than one person. Obviously, this is a problem because the syringe itself can become contaminated. 1% also stated they would re-enter a multi-dose vial with the same syringe and use a vial for another patient. This is also a perfect setup for transmission of bloodborne pathogens. And 9% of the respondents said they would sometimes or always use an IV bag as a common source for multiple patients. An infection control breach such as this can contaminate a bag of IV fluid and infect multiple patients. There are some limitations to this study. First of all, it was based on a self-report, and also it was a convenience sample. They emailed invitations to subscribers to a safety newsletter and relevant professional organizations. We'll leave it to you to think about how this might have biased the results. And these numbers might not seem like a lot, but think about how many injections are given in the facilities where you work. Let's talk a little bit about the CDC recommendations for safe injections. First, aseptic technique. This sounds simple, and we all know to wipe off the septum of a vial before accessing it. But there's more to ensuring that the medication in the vial or syringe isn't contaminated. And those points are addressed in the next several slides. Then, medication vials. The phrase, and a new syringe, is a key point here, because any time a needle could be contaminated, then so could the syringe it's attached to. I'll talk more about this on the next slide and in the case studies. Finally, don't leave a needle inserted into the septum of a vial. This is a perfect portal for bacterial contamination of the vial. Okay, so this sounds pretty simple. Needles and syringes should only be used for one patient, even if the needle is changed, even if the user doesn't draw back on the syringe, and even if the needle and syringe was only used to access an IV line separated from the patient by distance, gravity, or positive infusion pressure. Everyone understands that used needles are contaminated, and it's probably obvious to everyone that the syringes attached to those needles are also contaminated, but we still get questions about this and hear about problems with this. In New York State, most doctors and nurses and other healthcare providers have to take an infection control course every 4 years, and we still occasionally get calls from course instructors wanting references about syringe contamination because they've gotten questions from people who don't believe that a syringe could be contaminated and infectious if the user didn't pull back and the needle was changed. We've included some references in this podcast, and on one of the last slides of this presentation, you'll see that one reference was from the 1950s, indicating that contamination of the syringe does occur. The CDC also recommends that single-dose or single-use vials be used whenever possible. Also, the leftover contents of a used vial should never be combined to be used for additional patients. IV bags are to be used for only one patient, not as a common source of solution. And you'll note on an IV bag that it says either single patient use or single use only. Single dose vials should be one and done. CDC also has recommendations regarding multi-dose vials. Ideally, multi-dose injectable medications should be used for only one patient. However, we understand that that's not always possible. So when they're used for more than one patient can't be avoided, the vial should be dated and discarded within 28 days or according to the manufacturer's instructions. It should also be stored and accessed away from the immediate patient treatment area. The part about storing and accessing the vial away from the immediate patient care area is important. The point is to prevent accidental reentry with a used needle or syringe. Again, we want to have a robust system that makes it difficult to make mistakes. And if someone has to leave the room to get more medication from a multi-dose vial, it's much less likely that a contaminated syringe will be used. And finally, use a new sterile needle and syringe for each entry into the vial. CDC also recommends that hand hygiene be performed before handling medications. In addition, medications should be prepared in a clean area. This means that medications should not be prepared in areas where blood or other specimens are either stored or handled. Even if you can't see blood in an area, it could definitely be there, and it can lead to contamination of the medications. Lastly, always wear a mask when performing spinal injection. This applies to anyone in the room who's involved in the procedure based on cases of meningitis that have occurred after these procedures with organisms that are part of our respiratory flora. Next, let's talk a little bit about blood glucose monitoring and fingerstick devices. Remember that one should never reuse a fingerstick device for more than one person. Even with a new lancet, even if it's labeled for use on multiple patients, and even if it's cleaned and disinfected between uses according to the manufacturer's recommendations. There were some devices that have been marketed years ago that are still in use and may have instructions for cleaning and disinfection. However, these devices should not be used on multiple patients. They are designed for use on one person only. Let me just say a few words about cleaning and disinfection of glucometers. The most important thing is they have to be cleaned and disinfected per the manufacturer's instructions. And that has a lot to do with what chemicals are compatible with the device material. Whatever is used has to be effective against hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and HIV, and it needs to be applied to the glucometer for the specified contact time. We get questions very often about how to clean this equipment, but we really can't be more specific than that because it depends so much on the particular model and the disinfectant that's used. So before we move on to case studies, I just wanted to show you a screenshot of the One and Only campaign. This is a public health initiative sponsored by the CDC and the Safe Injection Practices Coalition, and New York State is a charter member of this coalition. So we often get questions, does this really happen? So let me talk to you about a few case studies. In October 2015, the Texas Department of State Health Services was notified that a hospital telemetry unit nurse had been reusing saline flush pre-filled syringes in the IV lines of multiple patients. The nurse was observed to frequently leave partially filled syringes near the workstation. State, regional, and local health departments, with consultation from CDC, collaborated with the hospital to investigate infection prevention lapses, assess risk to patients, perform patient notification, and provide bloodborne pathogen testing. When interviewed, the nurse reported reusing syringes for a six-month period. She believed it was safe and cost-effective. 392 potentially exposed living patients were recommended to be tested for hepatitis B, hepatitis C, and HIV, as all three of these viruses can be transmitted in similar manner. Among the 262 that were tested, four patients were identified with newly diagnosed bloodborne pathogen infection, two with hepatitis B virus, and two with hepatitis C virus. The hepatitis C virus was a rare genotype 4A, indicating likely transmission. No source for the patient identified for hepatitis B was found. In 2015, the New Jersey Department of Health was notified of an infection control breach. An experienced nurse had reused syringes for multiple patients at an employee influenza vaccination clinic at a New Jersey business. The nurse worked for a health services company and was contracted to provide vaccinations to employees at the business. The nurse was to bring pre-filled single-dose syringes, but an error brought three multi-dose vials of vaccine that were intended for another event. The nurse did not have syringes with her, but found two in her supply bag that she used to administer vaccine to 67 employees. She reportedly wiped the syringes with alcohol and used a new needle for each injection. Additionally, the nurse used two multi-dose vials of vaccine that were stored in an uncontrolled refrigerator at her home. This totaled 20 doses, and she administered the vaccine to 67 employees. Consequently, the employees did not receive the recommended dose of vaccine. The nurse surrendered her license within 1 week of the investigation. The New York State Department of Health was notified of an incident involving a new nursing graduate just off orientation who was working on the night shift in a hospital. Staff noticed that there were used single-patient use saline flush syringes lying on the medication cart. The nurse was interviewed and could not say that the syringes were never shared between patients. Therefore, the facility decided to notify the population at risk of the possibility of exposure to hepatitis B virus, hepatitis C virus, and HIV. Over 200 patients were recommended to be tested for hepatitis B virus, hepatitis C virus, and HIV. So that concludes the slide set. I'd like to acknowledge the contributions of Dr. Emily Lutterlow, the Director of the Bureau of Healthcare Associated Infections at New York State Department of Health, and Mary Beth Wanger in our Public Affairs Group. On the remaining slides, we've provided some resources and references that you may wish to have on hand should you be interested in providing this education to others or for your own information. Thanks for listening. And again, my name is Ernie Clement. I'm with the New York State Department of Health, Bureau of Healthcare Associated Infections.
You have just listened to a learning podcast on injection safety for nursing school students. For more information, please email icp@health.ny.gov.